Okay, welcome. It's great to have you all here at for this conversation. We are really thrilled and honored to have as our guests today Steve Ross, an alumnus of the law school, received his LLM in tax in 1966 from the law school here, just a couple of days
ago.
And Marty Edelman, who's a great friend of NYU, received an honorary degree from the university last May, and was really instrumental in, among many things, achieving the university's partnership with Abu Dhabi in the opening of the campus there. Steve and Marty are longtime friends and colleagues and collaborators, and in their two careers, we have spectacular examples of what one can do with a legal education. In the case of Steve, with the best possible legal education provided by NYU.
Of course.
And Marty's a great example of what you can do if you receive a slightly less good legal education from another school. He's been a wonderfully successful lawyer, counselor, and strategist to, among others, Steve Ross, and as I say, certainly to us here at NYU. So we're going to talk some about their careers, their lives in the law, decisions they've made, and how they reflect on them now. Steve, why don't we start with you? And
it's more about our lives outside the law.
Great. Well, I think that's actually a big part of the message here, is to talk about ways to imagine one's career after having been trained in the law that go well beyond the careers that you're most familiar with, namely the practice of law. And what the connection is between the education you receive here and the things you could go on to do well beyond the practice of law. Why don't we start at the beginning, Steve, with you. Where'd you grow up?
Well, I grew up in Detroit, and then my family moved to Florida when I was in my freshman year of high school.
Mm-hmm.
So I went to high school in Florida and then went back to school at the University of Michigan. thought I'd end up spending my life living in Michigan. And I went to law school there, and fortunately I had been in New York once, and I didn't know what I wanted to do when I graduated law school, and for sure, and I came to NYU and received my LLM, and it's probably the best decision I ever made in my life, and probably had more to change my life than anything else. It's coming here, getting to know what it was like to live in New York. And it was the greatest year of school that I ever had. And then I went back to Detroit to practice for 2 years. And then one day just woke up and said, I got to come back to New York.
And, wow. And so did you come back to New York to continue practice at first?
No, I went with an investment banking firm at that point. I guess having worked with a number of clients and I started doing a lot of real estate work, and a lot of the tax deals, structuring deals. I really enjoyed that, and then had the opportunity to go to Wall Street in the corporate finance department and try and concentrate on doing some real estate deals there. And then, you know, fortunately, that. It didn't work out well with me on Wall Street. I ended up getting fired for the wrong reason. I looked at myself and I said, you know, where are the opportunities and what do I know best? And I started my own company.
When was that?
When was that?
Yeah.
In 1971.
Wow. So that's a lot that happened in the first 5 years after after completing your LLM here. You'd already done a lot.
Well, I mean, a lot of people, like, I didn't really know when I was going, the whole period of going through school, what I really wanted to do. I hadn't found anything I really, that had really hit me. And I guess practicing law and doing, as a tax lawyer, but then doing a lot of corporate tax work as well as real estate, individual, the real estate is really, that started, you know, developing that interest in that field. And so, because you were dealing then with tangible things that you could create, and when I had these real estate developers coming to me and asking me for my decision, my thoughts, and they start following them, and you know, they were, you know, some of them were pretty successful gives you the confidence, hey, why can't I do this? And I really enjoyed it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I decided I would leave. It was more interesting to me at that point, you know, than practicing law.
Mm-hmm.
And so you develop your passion as you go along.
Mm-hmm.
You might not have it initially,
mm-hmm.
but it's something that I think the more you're out there, you get different perspectives and you grow.
And we'll talk about that growth. As everyone in the room knows, Steve's the chairman, the majority owner of the Related companies, as well as the Miami Dolphins. But through the Related, really is one of the most spectacularly successful and interesting leaders in the real estate field that there is in the world. And so the growth has been amazing. Let's involve Marty in this. So Marty, where did you grow up? And take us through law school and the beginning of your career.
So I grew up in White Plains and had a fairly conventional upbringing. I played the drums in a rock band, which was kind of the only deviant behavior and experiment with drugs that I really ever pursued. And then I went to Princeton and Columbia Law School. And then when I got home from the first day of my bar exam, of the two-day bar exam, I had a draft notice. So I spent the next 2 years, 2 years, 10 months, 20 days, and 7 hours in the Army Rangers during Vietnam. And I would say that actually eventually changed my thinking. It sort of opened me up to a world that I was never aware of that existed outside of New York. And although I came back and practiced law fairly routinely, of course, until I had the opportunity to meet Steve and start working with him, but really up until sort of the 1990s, I had just a normal practice of law, but I always did a lot of other things. And sort of having the experience in law school about, you know, sort of this notion of social responsibility that we talk about in conversations in law school, I started doing a lot of work with various charities and helped found the Jackie Robinson Foundation and the Intrepid Foundation. So my career has always had sort of a number of elements to it, and then it changed a lot in the last 15 years, really. But sort of my career opened up, actually, when I started doing work for Steve, and we developed a friendship during that time.
Marty is one of the most unique lawyers in the country, if not the world, and he probably has the largest roster of clients in almost every very field there is, and now it's foreign governments where he's really an advisor to them, and probably he was probably the most traveled person in this country, the way he leads his life, being in Abu Dhabi 1 hour and London a couple hours later, and then back to the United States, then back to Abu Dhabi. So don't let him think that he's just a typical lawyer.
Right.
He's totally unique.
Well, we're not looking to graduate typical lawyers. We like this path. So this is
Marty's different than anybody you're going to bring
up.
I
agree with that. Give us a sense, Marty, this last 15 years. What have been the components of your practice, which is...
So I had a very strange other very good friend other than Steve, and his name was Tommy Franks, and he was the commanding general of American forces in the invasion of Afghanistan and Iraq. And he called me one day and he said something that was not surprising, but apparently was surprising to him. He said, I'm seeing the heads of every Arab country, and they don't have any Jewish advisors inside the Arab country. And I said, I don't know why you find that surprising. So he said, get on a plane and come with me. And so in 2002, I got on a plane and I met the head of every country in the Arab world. And over these years, I've developed some relationships there that have been very interesting. I've been an advisor to NATO in Afghanistan. So I spend a lot of my life sort of on the road doing things that I never expected to do. And each one has that component that I think Steve is going to talk about a little more, which is that you get to look at a problem and think about it in a very trained and disciplined way, which gives you an enormous advantage over just about everybody else in the room. And that's what you're having here. You're learning how to think about problems and issues, and although they're in context in your daily classwork, when you go out there, it gives you an enormous amount of advantage and an opportunity to choose.
Steve, talk a little bit about the, just picking up on that theme. You said the year you spent here studying tax law was what the best year of school that you spent, I think, as is the way you put it. And how does that training that you received there connect to what you've been doing since leaving the practice of law and in business? How does the legal training, if you want even specifically the tax law training, connect to the skills that you use now and that have helped you succeed so incredibly in business?
Well, I think the legal training is something that you really teaches your mind how to think, much more so than any other aspect of school, at least it was for me. It seemed as I went to school, the longer I went, the better it got. And I really was, you know, kind of finding myself. I think that, so law school, I really enjoyed. I didn't really think I wanted to be a lawyer at that point, but I did enjoy tax. And I had a BBA before that, and I liked business. And like Marty, the draft influenced me to go to law school because I got my notice to take my physical, and I said, wait a minute, I was going to get my, I had one more year I could have gotten my MBA, and I said, I better just stay in law school. So I went and I applied to law school, so and continued that. And then when I came to NYU, which was really by far the best year of my life and probably the most influential, the law really teaches you how to, you're given a set of facts and it causes you to be creative and how do I then structure something to accomplish it but also minimize the tax impact on that. So you're constantly solving problems. This is a problem, how do I get around it? And that will serve you in law. It's great if you're good at that, and there's an incredible, great tax bar that does very well. It's not like most people think what tax law is all about. Mm. It's probably, I look at it as probably being the most creative aspect of law from that standpoint, because you're always looking in with a set of facts.
And we have our tax faculty nodding in vigorous agreement here.
Well, I mean, I really believe in New York, in NYU, I mean, it's by far, it probably still is, the best tax program in the country.
You know? Again, our faculty will not in vigorous agreement.
Okay. Yes. So, but it also causes you to be creative, you know, and this is what I really enjoyed, which led me to going into really real estate development. So, I mean, I think law is just a great background. I mean, having been involved in business and had an undergraduate degree and being involved with the business school at Michigan, I have a great deal of respect for it, but I think a lot of, in business, things come, you either have it or you don't have it. You can learn all you want, you know, about marketing and, you know, finance and all that, but, you know, it's a lot more instinctive. But in law, you really learn how to really think and solve problems, and I think it allows you to really be a little more creative. Mm-hmm. So I really cherish the fact that I did have a law degree, and I'm very thankful for that.
That's a great theme, I think, for us all to bear in mind, the idea that legal training can be a means to problem solving and itself even a source of creativity, which is not always the way we might experience law day to day in class and otherwise. But this notion of a skill set that's broadly portable, that can be, of course, the foundation for a successful career practicing law. But the practice of law over the course of one's career can change dramatically. And then one's career can pivot away from practice itself, but that the skills that you receive
are sharpened there. Let me tell you, the other sure. part of that is when you're outside, you can learn to hate lawyers really easily.
But tell them your views on that. Tell them why, Steve, because that's a... I think it's interesting.
No,
but tell them
Well, I mean, everybody would know that. I mean, you know, they're the greatest obstacle to getting things done as well when they're on the other side, you know. I mean, because I think just the thinking and knowing how to stop things or cause things to happen, I think that's one thing that the law really, you know, embeds within you. So, you know.
So the moral of the story is, don't be a lawyer on the other side of Steve Ross.
Well, that is the first, it's true force. You got to get through it. You know?
So I'll tell you one story, which Steve will remember. Steve went through a challenging period in the early 90s when real estate really took a dive. And his company was being restructured, recapitalized. And the lawyer on the other side of the table, who Steve knew, he was from Detroit because some of the financing was coming from Detroit. And he and I and Steve were often in a room, just the three of us, trying to sort of work things out. And he and Steve got so heated that they actually went across the table at each other, and I ended up being the one who got hit.
Are you going to try and deny this, Steve?
The other guy, I knew who the aggressor in that one was. You can guess.
So that's what friends are for, I suppose, Mark.
That's right.
Steve, a more recent chapter in your business life has moved beyond real estate to professional sports. And you, as I mentioned earlier, of course, you own the Dolphins. So what led to that decision?
Well, I've always been a great sports fan, love sports. And, you know, thank God I was in the position that I could afford to buy the team. Mm-hmm. That helps, you know.
It does help. You
know, people ask, well, why did you buy it? Is it because I could afford it? You know? but, I mean, I've always loved sports. And the opportunity, having spent, you know, 40-plus years, you know, in real estate and diversifying and, you know, knowing new, learning new things, and you know, it's a real industry in itself that I think has a lot of great opportunity today, I bought the sports team, but I also knew that in owning a professional football team, it opens a lot of doors that otherwise wouldn't open to you, and I didn't buy it. I mean, I bought it because one, I really felt that having created a company that I'm very proud of, and it's probably the greatest legacy of what I've accomplished is the related companies, mm-hmm. and what we are today and what we're doing. But being able to do the same thing in sports, which I'm finding out is not as easy as it is in business, to creating that winning, you know, organization. But that has opened up the doors to many other things for me, mm-hmm. in sports, and we're doing a lot of creative things, and it's been a great diversification.
Can you give us some examples of those things you're doing?
Well, I mean, just like, well, probably the easiest one that comes to mind is owning the team and the stadium in Miami, and seeing that when soccer Barcelona played Chivas, they drew 73,000 people, it's hard to sell. Miami's not a great sports town; it's an event city. And I saw the opportunities that existed for soccer in South Florida, and owning the stadium. So, and reading and seeing the popularity of soccer where it's going today, and having all the great European teams come here playing friendlies, and not believing that, you know, sports and friendlies don't really go together. It's a competitive situation, not a friendly situation. I didn't think how that could really last a long period of time. So I went out and found these promoters who had put together these friendlies with these European teams, and they were with CAA, and asked them if they could put together, bring, you know, 8 teams or so to this country that we could create a tournament. And it was all before the season. It's really like a preseason tournament in the United States, so that people were playing for something. And we created this tournament. I went to the television networks and said, if I can create this tournament with these type of teams, would you have an interest? And they said, yeah, you could do that. And we got we had both ESPN and Fox, and we made a deal with Fox. And we just finished our second year this year of the tournament, and we've had we have the team, the European teams from the EPL. We had Man U, Man City, Chelsea, Liverpool, the great teams from the Premier League. Then we have Real Madrid and the Italian teams. We had eight teams, and we've created this tournament. It's 2 years old. Last year we had 110,000 people, the largest soccer crowd ever at the University of Michigan, where Real Madrid played Man U. And so this tournament now is becoming something that we've created real value.
Absolutely.
You know, and it's just a question of utilizing our underutilized assets, which is owning stadiums. Mm-hmm. And we play it in, we played it in 13 different venues last year in the country. So, this was an opportunity that was there, but, you know, when you, once you own a sports team, you start to connect the dots. I think, you know, being successful in any business, it's really seeing what your basic business is and really connecting the dots so that you really are taking advantage of everything that you've really created or the, what you're owning or controlling. Mm-hmm. And so, we're now in sports marketing and a number of other, using technology in sports. We have a, creating a joint venture with the telcos and doing some things with the other major league sports leagues.
It's fascinating. So Man City, you have a connection to that team.
I do. This is the only time I've ever been on the opposite side of Steve. And he hasn't hit me yet, so it's pretty good.
No, it's been very, I always find Marty is, there's nothing better than Marty being on the opposite side. When I first started practicing law, and I had Marty as my attorney, after I finished every deal, the other side would hire Marty. You know, I mean, it was unbelievable. I mean, the deals got closed. There's never a deal. Once you have Marty representing you, you know you'll close the deal. And so.
Right, but you do accuse me of giving your money away.
That's a different issue. They closed, but it's a different issue.
So I'm Abu Dhabi owns Manchester City Football Club, and I'm one of the three board members. And so it opened up a world that I knew nothing about. Another example of, you know, if you just hang out on enough street corners, you're going to meet different people. So
that's some street corner.
Hang on the desert. Really.
So Manchester City, we spent a lot of money getting good players, and we won the English Premier League two of the last 3 years, and have been involved with Steve in developing this tournament idea, which is a very imaginative way of bringing football, soccer, to the United States. But so we have a different, slightly different approach to soccer, and that is that there are only a handful of legendary sports brands when you think about it, you know, sort of the Dallas Cowboys, New York Yankees, and Man United, and Barcelona.
Miami Dolphins.
Right. Miami Dolphins. Household names.
The NYU Violet.
Never go anywhere without seeing that that jersey. And so we actually own Manchester City. We own the franchise for the Major League Soccer team in New York, which will start next March. We own a team in Melbourne. We own, we operate a team in Japan, and I'm in the process actually of negotiating for teams in China, Indonesia, and India. So the what Steve said is really true. Sports at his unique level of being one of 32 owners has opened up a whole world for him. And even at what I'm doing, it's opened up a whole international world. So, you know, I think the great thing about what you have the opportunity to do is to not only do what you're doing and learning here, but really, Trevor used the word portable, but really it's, you can take it on the road and you can go anywhere. Because if you have the self-confidence then you're going to be a unique person in every room and every place you go, because you're not going to be afraid of a problem. You're going to know that you have to think through a problem and come out the other end of it with a suggestion. And Steve makes a very important point. There's a way to conduct a discussion being a lawyer in which you end up with a positive result or you end up with a negative result. And even a negative result can be presented as a solution. So it takes a bit of psychology, but what you're learning here equips you to really do anything you want in any area.
Another, I suppose, opportunity and challenge that's presented itself for you, Steve, in the course of owning the Dolphins is the one that brought you back in touch with the law school not quite a year ago. Why don't you talk a little bit about how Marty and you and I met late in 2013 and the project we've been working on since then.
Sure.
We have Arthur Miller in the back, who's been really a key leader in this effort as well. But give us a sense of that project.
Well, I mean, owning the Dolphins and, you know, it really goes back, though, to my whole philosophy is, you know, that you when you can make an impact, you know, and you have the opportunity that you can have a real impact on society and life, you want to take advantage of it, you know, and do something that's transformative. And I've always looked in my life whenever something negatively has happened, how do you create a positive out of it? And we had this issue last year with this bullying incident we had with, you know, the front page for God knows how many weeks, you know, with Jonathan Martin and Richie Incognito and what went on. And, you know, so, you know, I did my own little investigation talking to the parties and I saw what had happened there, and it obviously was behavior that was totally unacceptable and the lack of respect that how people would treat each other. And at that same time, before I was really to be kind of interrogated by the league in terms of what I knew about it and who was to blame, I was in Detroit. The governor had asked me to come out there and I to see if I could help get involved in Detroit. I brought the Secretary of Housing and Urban Development, and they gave us a great tour of Detroit. And as I toured Detroit and saw the place where I grew up and how wonderful it was, and seeing it the way it was today, you know, I realized it was just a product of racism. And I saw the fact when I went, and the next day it really hit me. And when I really, you know, reflecting on what was going on in Miami, it was just part of that same type of issue that exists in this country. And so that I felt that here I kind of own that territory when people talk about sports and racism, bullying, lack of respect, they're always going to refer to the Miami Dolphins. And, you know, and they still do. So the question is, how do you take that and make a real positive out of it? And then working with Marty, who introduced me to Trevor, and brought in Arthur Miller, we talked about how, and Arthur heads up the Center for Sports and Society, isn't that what it's called? And how, and the impact that they can have and what they want to do. And I felt with what, how I could bring it together and create a nonprofit that could have a change and make some really have a real impact on society, that we put this nonprofit together that we're working together with, that I think, and right now we've gotten all the leagues to be part of it, all in all sports, because people realize no league wants to stand up and say, hey, we want to, you know, we have this problem, but I think everybody recognizes society has this problem, and you never know when it's going to rear its ugly head, and that we can do something about it, and that's what we're in the process of doing, and I think we can have a real impact on America.
It's a hugely important undertaking, and to be taking on the problem of racism in society through sports, in a way? I mean, that you're not shying away from one of the biggest problems that we have.
Well, you know, I mean, you know, sports is really the least common denominator in this world today. You know, I mean, it impacts everybody, and it doesn't matter what economic level, you know, race, religion, or color, people love sports. It brings us all together. And I think through that, and athletes are certainly role models. And when you're dealing with people who are role models that can impact people, you know, you can maybe hopefully make some inroads and create change. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what, you know, we're attempting to do. I think we can have an impact. It's nothing that's going to happen easily or fast or anything, but you got to start somewhere. And I think all the leagues today have really embraced this. They see it, you know, it's an issue. I think the media and where sports is today, as in society, with the way the media is and how important it is, that they know they have to get behind it as well. Mm-hmm. It's important for all the leagues and everybody. It's important for this country.
And so the key of it really is education, ultimately, right?
There's no question. I mean, you got to start, you know. The way we're approaching is when kids start playing organized sports for the first time, that they'll be educated, there'll be programs there, the coaches will be educated about it, and we'll talk about a pledge that they'll take, that they'll treat people with respect, and what it means, and doing that throughout their whole careers, through college as well as professionalism. And I think that working everybody together, this is going to have an impact.
I think here again, there's just a hugely valuable lesson for all of us. I mean, Steve has had this spectacularly successful career in business, and that's created a set of opportunities that not everyone would seize, but that you've seized to, as you put it, to make a difference, to make change, to have an impact on the public broadly, on society broadly. There's a connection there between the private success, if you want, that you've had, and a most understanding of a public mission.
Well, the question is, what is success?
Mm-hmm. How do you define it?
You just can't measure it in monetary dollars. You know, it's really the impact you can have, you know, at the end of the day, in making the world a better place. You know, and I learned a lot of that from Mr. Edelman there, who was one who started the Jackie Robinson Foundation, and we share those common thoughts. I think Marty leads your life the same type of way.
Yeah, I think it's important, actually. Jackie wrote a book with a guy named Al Duckett, and the sort of the quotation was, a life should be measured only by the impact it has on others. And as you sort of go through this period in your life, you can actually start making choices now about the things you do in addition to law school, where they can have an impact on other things through the pro bono opportunities you have, and just, you know, the people you hang around with, and where you go in the evenings and where you go on weekends. All of that provides opportunities to really make a difference. And, you know, you make a difference with one person and then with more than one person, and pretty soon it has an impact. When Steve called me about the bullying, you would have thought that a different owner would say, I have a problem. But that wasn't the way he looked at it. What he said was, this is the microcosm of everything that's still wrong in our society, and it's evidenced mostly by the way people treat each other. And so he took this opportunity and exploded it. And that's, I think, the sort of the lesson of Steve's life is that with energy and determination and sort of a certain amount of intelligence, you can really take something, surround yourself with the kind of people who can help you achieve something, and there's no limit. I mean, Steve and I kid each other that at our advanced age, we should really be learning how to use a walker. And we spend all our time running up airplane steps. So I think that what law school did, it was a steroid injection for both of us. And
to continue the sports metaphor.
Yeah, don't say that. You know, right now, I can see now Roger calling me. being fined.
But it wasn't banned then. So, I mean, I think, you know, what you see in both of us is just a couple of very lucky people who actually took advantage of every bit of luck they ever had and turned the things that weren't so lucky into figuring out a way to do something with it. And even if it was a lesson learned, I mean, you know, we've both had experiences that weren't perfect, but each time—
Nobody does.
Each time we sort of figured, okay, you know, you have a choice. You either go home and cry or you go to the next one, and we always went to the next one.
I think that's a key ingredient of leadership, really, is learning from these experiences and then thinking about ways to make impact beyond the immediate circumstance, seeing in the Dolphins locker room not just an organizational problem that needed solving, but an opportunity to move the needle on one of the most profound social problems we have in the United States. That's leadership for you to have taken.
Well,
that
I mean, when these negative things happen, you know, it causes you to think a lot more than otherwise. I mean, you know, it's like you learn most by your failures or mistakes. Mm-hmm. You don't learn by your success. Mm-hmm. And I think that because when you do have failure, you think, why did it happen and how do you avoid it and what do you do next time? So it's a much more positive, it should have be a much more positive aspect in your future growth. Absolutely. And I think that's how I've really approached things. And I think you can grow a lot more if you look at it as from a positive standpoint as opposed to a negative standpoint.
Mm-hmm. I've got a bunch more questions, but I bet you do too. So let's open it up now and we'll come back with a few closing questions, but would invite people in the audience who have questions, raise your hand and we'll bring a microphone over to you. Yes, sir. Why don't you tell us your name and what year of law school you're in, if you're here, or if you're an undergraduate, what you're studying?
Yeah, my name is Rumbo and I'm a 1L. This is a question for Mr. Ross. So when you started your own tax advising firm in 1972, how did you get clients?
No, I worked for a large firm in Detroit.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And that's when I graduated law school, and that was in 1966. Right. Okay, I moved to New York in 68 and started my own firm in real estate development in 71.
Did you already, when you started that firm, Steve, did you already know who you needed to know in order to be successful?
No, I mean, I had just been fired, and I, like I said, and I tried to say, what's the positive of that? And that caused me to really, you know, what are my strengths, what are my weaknesses, and where the greatest opportunities lie, you know, in what I know and what I really care about, and where I had some passion for it, or at least what I thought I had a passion for, you know, at that time. So I decided I couldn't go out and work for somebody else. I didn't, you know, it was time to really, you know, figure out what I could do best and assessing what I thought I knew best. So, and I created a positive out of that, you know, and it's just a way I've always looked whenever I have some type of failure, you know, as I said before, but, I mean, when I started business, I mean, I didn't know anything really when I think about it today. And it was just an idea, and people, the great thing about New York, and I must say, is people don't care, you know, who you are or where you're from. It's what you know and how you can express it. Because the opportunities in New York, I think, are greater than any other place in the United States. Mm-hmm. People are here because they want to be successful. And it's a great place to start a business. It's a great place to live and to grow because New Yorkers, they all scatter about. It's not, you know, what country club you're at or, you know, who your parents are or anything else. People, if you have something positive to say or you can do or you can help somebody, you know, everybody has their ears open and, you know, and are wanting to do that because they're seeing how it can help them. And the opportunities are here.
I agree. Other questions? Yes, of course the guy in the Dolphins jersey has a question.
Hey, my name's Rohan. I'm a 2L JD MBA student, and I wanted to know how exactly does, you mentioned that the legal education was very important for your development in your career, but how is your business and education combined with your legal education in order to get you where you are today?
Well, like I said before, I mean, it really taught me how to think, you know, and I use it today. I mean, you know, there's no one way to the top or being successful, you know. I mean, today it takes a lot of different skills, probably more so than ever. And, but I think the fact is, you know, it's all about how you think and react to things and look at things. And I think a legal education, you know, really opens your mind to thinking in a certain organized way and will lead you to conclusions. And you know you have to make a conclusion, you know, in law. Mm-hmm. And I mean, it worked for me. But I mean, there's many guys that are, you know, equally successful that didn't have law degrees. But, you know, this is what worked for me. And I, you know, certainly a big advocate of having a law degree, because I think it, being able to think a certain way and understand everything that's going on around you, you know, puts you in a better position to succeed.
Yes, in the back.
Hi, I'm Jonah Lowenfeld. I'm a MBA 1 at Stern, and I had an open question. I won't address it to either of the panelists, and it's about training other leaders. Much has been made about the generational shift and how leaders today may have different motivations that are driving them. I wonder if you guys, as you know, senior members in organizations and people who've mentored younger people, might have some observations about what you see and maybe how we as future leaders can improve.
You want to start, Marty?
Why, because it's a hard question.
Yeah, exactly. I'm giving Steve time to think.
I'm only a businessman. You're a lawyer.
So I think there is a huge change. And I think one of the interesting needs of leaders today is actually to be more open-minded. So we came into organizations with, in a way, fewer challenges, and they were more easily understood. They were less impacted by the scope of the world we have today. Today, decisions that you make about where you go, what you do, what you invest in, who your friends are, can be impacted by what's happening in the Middle East, which is tragic, by what's happening in Latin America. And so I think you have to be much more aware today as a young leader than we did. And I think one of the interesting things about law school is law school helps you understand that there's a conclusion to things. So whether you have a case or a bit of advice or you're working on a project, there's a conclusion to it. And if it's a court case and it has implications, there's a decision made, and you have to adjust to that decision. And so take that and put it in an organizational context, whether it be for social welfare or for justice issues or just for something personal. You have to be prepared to be willing to look at what's happening, understand it, and be open to change. And I think that's a lesson that we were less capable of understanding because it wasn't happening as much. While we grew up in the civil rights era where there was tumultuous change, it was in a very focused way. The rest of life was a little more conventional and a little more predictable. Steve took the opportunities of being a tax lawyer and actually built the foundation of his business about working with the tax code, because it had a social policy incentive related to housing built in it, and he understood it better than anybody else. So it was just a different environment. I think you all need to be smarter, more flexible, you know, get less sleep and pay attention more.
I'm going to pretend you put the question to me as well, and to say that part of that change, I think, means institutionally the obligation of a school like ours changes too. I think we need to think about, we were talking about this a little bit just before the session, that legal education today, I think, needs to have an interdisciplinary quality to it that it hasn't in the past. And we, as legal educators, need to think about leadership as something that we're actually trying to teach. That there's a teachable set of skills here that actually business schools, I think, have had as part of their curricula for some time now. But if it's true that there's a kind of critical thinking set of skills that law schools are especially well-equipped to teach people in, then an additional component of what law schools do, I think, is preparing these people who have this great set of skills to be effective leaders, and to think that there are components of that leadership that can be part of what we're teaching here. And so many of you in the audience, I'm sure, will have heard already, whether it's Vice Dean Jeannie Forrest or others on our team, talking about leadership as a component of what we're trying to prepare you for as law students here. And that's no accident. That's an intentional move by us as a school to think that in view of the greater complexity of the world, that we are trying to take that on and help you take that on by preparing you to be leaders, lawyers, and leaders. Other questions? Yes.
Hi, I'm Josh Ashtell, a third-year JD MBA, and to Mr. Ross, related, obviously a big player in affordable housing, multifamily in general, and you're just a big player in shaping the city. I was wondering, going forward, we talk about this a lot at the law school, especially now that Professor Bean's at HPD, what do you see as ways that the municipal government can work with people such as yourselves in solving what people view as an affordable housing crisis going forward in New York City?
Well, I mean, building affordable housing in New York City, you know, is something we've probably built a lot of, but it's something that's a difficult task to do on a large scale because of the amount of dollars and subsidies that are required. And I mean, there are ways of doing it, and you know, I would hope that you have to be creative, and we've kind of met with, you know, the public officials and given them some ideas. But it's a question how creative and how far out of the box they want to think. I mean, it's a bold undertaking, but I think it can be done. But it's going to take some bold moves as opposed to just talking about it, you know. And we'll see if it's, you know, we have an administration that indicates it's committed to it. But I don't know if they just want to keep talking about it or really do it.
Questions. Steve, you mentioned before that one of, we didn't cover this, that in addition to the incredible successes you've had, you've, especially in recent years, been publicly identified with a huge commitment to philanthropy. What drives that?
Well, I mean, it was like, you know, my goal was always to do something, you know, it's going to keep growing as a person and, you know, trying to make the world a better place. And I was, you know, taught early by my family, you know, that, you know, there's a sense of, you know, giving back. And it's always been in the back of my mind. When you're in a position to give back, you know, there's nothing better, you know, than giving. You know, I've chaired a few campaigns, I always say, you know, you give till you feel good. And there's nothing better, you know, than really giving. And fortunately, I've been in a situation that I can, and it's something that I really enjoy. And I think everybody, you know, if you approach life that, you know, no matter what level, that you want to make it a better place than when you came here, there's, you know, it's a tremendous, and as you achieve success, you know, there's nothing better than giving back.
There again, I think you set yourself apart. It's not the case that everyone views the world that way, but it's certainly an avenue.
You got to do what makes you feel good, too.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, you know? That's true. Other questions? Yes.
My name is Mihai Marama, 1L here at the law school. This is a question for both panelists. You mentioned twice the idea of making the world a better place. If there's one thing, if there's one thing you could change about it, what would it be and why?
About the world?
Yeah.
You've got some latitude there.
Marty's doing it on a much broader scale. He's looking at the real world today as he's an advisor to the, a lot of, to the Middle East. And, why don't you address that, Marty? It's the tougher question.
So the simple answer is to improve airplane food. I think the harder answer is to take take what Steve started with, this anti-bullying, which you translate into the need to respect people. The single largest obstacle to peace in the places where there are turbulence is the either inability or unwillingness of various groups to communicate, to talk to each other, to think that there's a way to resolve conflict in a peaceful way. So whether you go to the tribal areas in Afghanistan, or you go to places in Africa, or you go to places in China where there are minorities that are being oppressed, you understand that the blockage is that people who are different, people who don't agree either for a religious reason or political reason, are viewed as an enemy, or are viewed as inferior, or viewed as, it's the continuation of really the sort of what infused the Nazi purge of Jews in Germany. We still have it now all over the world. You can change one place, but you basically have to change the education of people. So I think if there's one thing that if I could, you know, wave a magic wand, I would have some kind of uniform world education policy that in effect gave up peace for the next 50 years, but assured it for the hundreds of years thereafter.
It is connected to the problems that we're taking on through the initiative to address race and bullying in sports, right? Root causes are common.
That's a real macro issue in the United States.
Right.
You know, and I think that, you know, I like to be active in what I'm doing and using the skills I have. And, you know, more or less, like in New York City, we're very active in, you know, I think in making the city a greater place. It's a much more of a micro, you know, impact I have, because I can be more active in doing that other than just, you know, giving money. Marty is really giving his time and effort and seeing things in a much more of a macro, you know, impact. But to me, New York City's not a bad place to start, you know, so it's, you know, it's dealing with the cultural institutions, it's, you know, the things that we can do with Hudson Yards and what that will mean to New York City, because I think it's going to be a shift of gravity of this whole city and making it a greater place.
Steve, tell them about the cultural shed.
Yeah.
Why don't you tell them about
that? Well, culturally, look at every city. You know, you need great culture institutions. And I think in working with those institutions, creating new ones, which we're doing at Hudson Yards, we'll be creating a place at Hudson Yards that providing in the plaza there, which is bigger than Trafalgar Square in London or what have you, that creating what will be, or what the Eiffel Tower is to Paris, we'll be putting in our plaza. And I think it'll really be an icon for New York for the future. But it's all part of making the city and keeping the city, you know, the world's greatest city. And we've had a role in that, and we look at it as an obligation, a responsibility. We've been very fortunate, you know, in having the opportunity to do some of these transformational projects. And certainly the most impactful one will be Hudson Yards, because it's the largest project ever developed in the United States. So that's a responsibility, but you can really, you know, do an awful lot of good with it. And I'm very involved also with the environment, you know, and how the impact that's going to be on the environment as well as cities. So I mean, my giving and giving back has really been in the issues of things that I can have a direct knowledge of and can really be involved and an active participant in making better, you know. And I've been lucky I've had these opportunities.
New York is lucky that you have. A couple of questions. Yes.
My name's Elaine, MBA 2. This question's for Steve. If you had to start over as a real estate entrepreneur or a developer again in the city, what would you do?
I'd probably do the same thing. I'd start in affordable housing. I think it's a great way to learn. And it also, it's more complex, and it sets you up to be in a position to do things that are a lot easier, you know. But it also, you know, there's not a lot of risk factors. It's more of using your brains and trying to figure out, you know, how to accomplish something. And it can lead to a lot of, at least it did for me, you know, it opened up the world.
Yes.
Given that,
here's the microphone for it.
Hi, I'm Denzel Cadet. I'm a 3L. Given that someone doesn't get to the position that you gentlemen are in overnight, what is a practical habit that you've maintained and kind of developed through the years that you think has really contributed to your success?
I think the most important thing you can do for yourself, you know, because, you know, what is success and how do you define it, is really to do something that you have a passion for. And if you have a passion for something, you're going to do it well, and it's not like you're working. Like, I don't feel when I go to the office every day I'm going to work, you know, and there's nothing more rewarding than that. That you can really enjoy what you're doing. So I think everybody should, you know, if you can find what you really have a passion for, you know, I proceed with that and you're going to be successful.
So this may sound silly, but I think staying awake. No, let me just elaborate for a second.
It's clearly important.
Go into every class, every room, every social activity you go into, and you know that some people in that room are not engaged. And so they're missing something. Now, it may not be important, but it may be. So the question is, if you're not going to stay awake and do everything you can do in every setting you're in, you're taking the risk of missing something. So if you want to have a career that's successful, measured in any way, you better just engage. Because that, if you engage, you'll find what Steve's talking about. If you don't have it the first day, it'll come the fifth day, or you'll see something that just is, you know, this is what I want to do.
It's very true.
Yes?
Troy Green, MBA 2. Going further than that, I think, in my personal opinion, behind any great success is a partnership. So what are your thoughts on navigating your career and forming partnerships? Maybe you can reflect on recovering from a bad partnership or how you've, you know, or a good one, or how you've continued to, you know, progress through that.
Well, I mean, I think to be successful, no one person, you know, can do everything themselves. You have to have, you know, great partners. I mean, in building a company, I think, you know, it's the people you hire, you know, and that really tells you what that company is going to be all about, you know. I think, you know, Steve Jobs said, you know, you can, if you want to be an A company, you got to hire A people. And, you know, I looked at it, I wanted to hire people who I thought were smarter than I am. And, you know, you can't be intimidated by, you know, by people. You want to surround yourself with the best people possible. They have the same kind of values, or at least you try to impart your values, you know, on them as you hire younger people, and you work together as a team, and you know, you can accomplish a lot more. I mean, no one person can accomplish, you know, great things without having great people around them.
Yeah, I mean, I can echo that. So when I coached Little League 1 year, I drafted 7 young kids who were catchers, and everybody thought I was crazy. But the truth is, at 7 and 8 years old, catching is the hardest position. So they were actually the best athletes. So they played all different positions. If you get the best athlete or the best person, you're gonna be successful. So yeah, and guess what? You're gonna make a lot of bad choices. I mean, you know, Steve and I have both trusted people who maybe didn't live up to the standards that we thought we had. And you know, all you have to do is say, that's life, and move on. You can't succumb to not trusting, because if you don't trust, you're never gonna have relationships. So you gotta take the risk of being disappointed. And again, it's the same thing. It's getting up every day and saying, you know, I'm gonna have a good day or a bad day, but I'm gonna keep doing it.
All right, drafting catchers as the advice. I didn't know that we'd get
that. I thought it was quarterbacks.
Same principle, I think. Yes.
Hi, thank you for coming today. It's been great. My name's Sam. I'm pursuing my MBA. And my question is real estate is such a relationship-based business, and even given the tools we have today with technology, still requires a very localized knowledge base. And I'm curious if you could speak to how you've grown a national and even international firm, you know, given that dynamic of the real estate industry.
Well, I mean, real estate is a local business. There's no question about it. I mean, but there's certain skills that, you know, you can have that you can transport to other places. But I think that on the ground, doing things on a day-to-day basis, you want to have local people who really understand, you know, that community or that place. And it doesn't matter if it's, you know, other places in New York, California, or, you know, Europe or any foreign country. It is a local business, and you want to have local people involved in it. But that doesn't mean that you can't transport your expertise and your thinking and your vision to other places.
Hi there, my name is Evan, I'm a 3L. I was wondering if you foresee Sharia banking, Sharia compliant investing as becoming specialty groups within law firms, or is that kind of knowledge you're going to need to be familiar with as a transactional associate generally?
It's helpful if you're going to do transactions in the Middle East where Sharia compliance is at least honored in name, as with everything else, including our tax code. There's a way you comply and then you actually achieve a different economic objective. It's less normal for Sharia principles to be applied when foreign money comes here. But to the extent you're doing things in the Middle East or North Africa, in some societies, you're going to have to understand it at least. It's not something that you really, unless you're going to go and practice law in the Middle East, it's not something that is going to be critical. I don't know if there'll be a whole department in a law firm, but there'll certainly be someone who does understand it and can use it and can work with it. But Steve's doing a huge project, which is just actually been announced in Abu Dhabi, and we've not had to actually comply with Sharia for any of the aspects of it.
Hey, Alex Leibowitz, MBA 1. I know that Related is working with NYU on essentially a big data program at Hudson Yards. Can you talk a little bit more about what that's going to look like on a day-to-day basis and how you hope to maybe expand that program to other developments around the world?
Well, I think it's CUSP, which is part of NYU, yeah, which is going to be collecting all this big data. And I don't think they even know how they're going to use all of it. Today, it's a collection of data, and then trying technology and I think time and experience will, you know, really show us all what we can use all that data for. But I think Hudson Yard will be the most monitored project ever built, and you know, we'll see where that leads to. But I know that you know, I'm involved with the World Resource Institute and how in building cities and sustainable cities and using that data and how we can use that in other places and the experience we'll get from that. Where it's going to lead, I don't think anybody really knows, but I certainly, you know, with that information, I think we're going to learn an awful lot.
So we might have time for Let me ask one last question to both of you. You've got this room full of eager students, law students, business school students, people pursuing joint degrees. What advice would you give them? But to both of you, Marty.
I mean, the opportunity to learn in an urban environment is, I think, extraordinary. If you look what's happening to demographics around the world, it's just, you know, sections of congestion everywhere. And the whole world is is becoming urban in a sense. So your experience here, being able to navigate life here with the challenges of a heavy educational institution and the challenges of living in a, you know, civilized society, but it's still, it's New York, so it's active and pressured and things happen that are bad as well as good, I think will enhance the learning you're having and equip you to go anywhere. I mean, there's no reason you shouldn't be having periods of time in your lives in China, in Africa, in the Middle East. I mean, Europe's easy because it's more like here. South America, that world is open to you, and I think you're unusually equipped to navigate it because of the fact that you're in this extraordinary educational institution in an extraordinary city, which, by the way, he helped build.
Okay.
I say not nice things about it. Thank you, smaller crowds.
I thought I paid you legal fees, not PR fees.
No, actually, you're paying neither these days.
It's interdisciplinary, Steve, you know.
Well, everything is becoming, I mean, the way the world is changing, it's changing so fast, and there's, you know, the way the workforce is today and how people work together. I mean, it's so much different than when I went to school. It's so much more interdisciplinary, you know, as opposed to just being in silos. And being able to work together, I think, is so important. There's so much opportunity out there. With change, it creates opportunity and things you don't even see because they're not really there today. So I think really is the ability, you know, to work with great people, to work together, the ability, I think, is so important today. And the idea, and to do something that you really are passionate about. And if you can put those things together, you will be successful. And you know, the more change you have, the more opportunities you all will have. And I think that's what exists there today.
That's great advice from both of you. I want to thank both of you for being with us today. I think it's just been a terrific conversation. You're both holders of NYU degrees, and we're immensely proud of that.
We wish we could be out in the audience today as a student, yeah. And starting all
You're
over
welcome
again.
To come back anytime. I'll tell you. Welcome to come back anytime.
Like to trade places.
Please join me in thanking Marty Edelman and Steve Ross.